In this video, we are going to be covering the top three most common response types that you are going to receive when calling and emailing suppliers. Let's jump right into it. What's going on, YouTube? Welcome back to my channel. For those of you who are new, on this channel, we explore tips, strategies, and experiences that I have had that will help you start and build up your Amazon FBA wholesale business. In this video, guys, we are going to cover the top three most common response types that you are going to hear from suppliers and companies when you reach out to them to close a wholesale account. The inspiration for this video comes from my own experience. As you guys know, I've been contacting a lot of companies in the recent months, and I have been hearing these response types over and over again. So my goal of this video is to share these response types with you so that you can go into these phone calls and emails ready, prepared with a response that you can say to these companies. So before we jump into it, if you guys do enjoy these videos, make sure to smash that like button, hit that subscribe button and notification bell if you want to stay up to date on all of the future wholesale content that we will be putting out. Without further ado, let's jump right into the content. It's important to keep in mind that for these three response types, we are getting past the first initial phase of we are not accepting Amazon sellers. So guys, this is the most common response type that you are going to receive. However, the top three response types that I included in this video are not we are not selling to Amazon sellers, because you, in order to get to these three most common response types, you have to dig a little bit deeper and actually communicate and talk with the brand owner or the sales representative at the company and determine what are the actual underlying reasons that they are not taking on Amazon vendors. And it comes down to the three most common reasons. Reason number one is that adding more sellers dilutes the current competition and creates more competition in the industry of selling on Amazon. Guys, a lot of these companies have been working with vendors on Amazon for years, and they don't want to disrupt their existing relationships with these vendors because of adding one, two, three, or four sellers. Guys, we've all seen it with a product that has 50 sellers on a listing and nobody ends up getting any sales because everyone has to share a division percentage of the buy box. And as we know, the buy box doesn't even rotate equally anymore. So really adding all of these sellers does nothing for the company, and it doesn't even do anything for the sellers because they're not selling it anyway because there's too much competition. So that's reason number one, is a dilution of the market and an oversaturation of sellers. The most common response type number two is a long history of MAP violations. Guys, adding more sellers to a product listing increases the company's chance for pricing policies to be violated. It's just the nature of the game. When we start to add more competition, naturally speaking, one vendor is going to undercut by a penny, and we've all seen it spiral downward from there, and everyone just keeps undercutting each other by a penny here and a penny there, and before you know it, the retail value of the product is half of what it was originally. So guys, companies do not want to expose this risk for their brand. Violating MAP policies does two things. A, it hurts vendors' margins, and B, it destroys the value and integrity of a brand. Guys, if the brand has a suggested retail price or a MAP price of, let's say, $29.99, and that product makes its way down to $25.99 or $19.99, the integrity and the real value associated with that product is reduced by that lower price point. And we're going to get in towards the end of the video about how that affects companies' brick and mortar stores and outside markets as well. Let's jump into reason number three. Reason number three that companies are not taking on more Amazon sellers is because they are convinced that it hurts their brick and mortar distributors. Guys, companies are having an extreme pullback from the Amazon marketplace and they're focusing heavily on brick and mortar. As we know, over the past year and a half, we have seen a significant decline in brick and mortar locations, tons of stores closing down. And I mean, Amazon has grown exponentially, online sales have grown exponentially. And what's happening is a lot of companies' brick and mortar locations are either shutting down or they're no longer able to purchase from them. So companies want to support their mom and pop brick and mortars, and they're convinced that if they continue to sell to Amazon sellers do nothing but bring the price down, devalue the product, and just cause all of these issues. So what ends up happening is, why would a customer purchase the product at a brick and mortar facility for $30 when they can go on Amazon and get it for $25 or $20? So that customer now has no reason to go to the brick and mortar store and purchase it for $30. A, they don't have to leave the comfort of their home, and B, they can get the product $5 or $10 cheaper. So it just doesn't make sense for them to continue to take on Amazon sellers because it's hurting their brick and mortar locations. And brick and mortar does have to sell it for that higher price threshold because a brick and mortar facility has way more overhead than, say, an Amazon business. You know, a brick and mortar facility has electricity, employees, just a bunch of rent, overhead costs that traditionally an Amazon seller, maybe just starting out, someone that's not maybe a big seller, does not have to handle all of these overhead costs. So we'll very commonly see that a lot of these companies will allow you to sell on your own website. They will allow you to sell their products if you have a brick and mortar store. They will allow you to sell their products on maybe Walmart.com or eBay.com. They will not allow you to sell their products on Amazon.com. So this is what we have to really explore. Why is this happening? Why are companies having such a severe pullback from the Amazon marketplace? And the only way to formulate our value propositions is to do your research, contact the companies, and learn why. In this video, I'm explaining to you the top three reasons as to why companies and vendors are not taking on more Amazon sellers. And if you take these reasons and go into your phone calls and emails with this in mind, you will be able to formulate yourself an argument that ultimately derives your conclusion as the best possible scenario for the company. Now, I'm not saying this is going to enable you to close a bunch of wholesale accounts. My rejection rate still far exceeds my acceptance rate. But guys, as long as we understand the pain points associated with this, we can actually formulate ourselves an argument. We can formulate ourselves a position that enables us to close more wholesale accounts than if we simply went into the phone call blindly, not understanding the lay of the land. So I hope this video helped you guys understand a little bit more about the top three reasons associated with why vendors and companies are not taking on more Amazon sellers. Before we close out the video, I just want to remind you guys that all of these companies are receiving contacts from Amazon sellers, whether it's phone calls, it's actually mostly emails. A lot of vendors are not contacting via phone. That's why I always advocate to contact on the phone over email, because you can hear tonality and just a whole bunch of other reasons as to why the phone has a higher success rate than an email. But companies are receiving tons and tons of inquiries, you know, by the day, by the week, by the month, they're receiving tons of inquiries from Amazon vendors. That is why you have to distinguish yourself from the rest. It's really important that you sound genuine and authentic, and you understand the industry, and you're operating a full-fledged business, and you are not simply an Amazon seller. Separate yourself from Amazon sellers, and I promise you guys, it is going to prove profitable for you in the long run. I hope this video helped you understand more about these three reasons. If you guys enjoyed this video, make sure to smash that like button. It really helps out these videos in the YouTube algorithm. If you enjoyed this video, hit that subscribe button and notification bell to stay up to date on all of the future wholesale content that I will be putting out. Thank you guys so much. Stay safe, stay healthy, and we will see you next time.